So if we're talking about Noah, we obviously have to talk about the exodus of talent that occurred in the year 2000 from All Japan, which later formed Noah. If you want the full breakdown, you can look it up, but you can also look at your boy's video on it. But basically, it was a dispute between star wrestler and, at the time, president of All Japan, Mitsuharu Misawa, and the widow of the former president and head booker and founder of All Japan, Giant Baba, his widow, Makoto Baba. There was infighting within the company that eventually led to Misawa stepping down as president. So then when you saw the writing on the wall saying, it doesn't feel like I'm welcome here, depending on who you hear the story from. And again, this all this stuff is a little shaky in terms of what's being reported, but the general story is that there was infighting between Misawa and Makoto Baba. So Misawa said, you know what, I'm going to set off on my own path, my own voyage, and create this new promotion. As you could tell with the name Pro Wrestling Noah, there's a lot of relation between the story of Pro Wrestling Noah, the story of Mitsuharu Misawa's kind of venture out into the pro wrestling world, and that of Noah, as in Noah's arc. There's, you know, in terms of the events, there's talking about voyages and about discovery and different things, and even down to the promotion, the logo itself. It all harkens back to the story of Noah, which is interesting. It's unique. The only other time that you can think of that is like maybe like wrestling and romance, that like the promotion has like a theme associated with it, or maybe like some other promotions. But that's something to take into account, because it kind of shows the idea that Misawa had for a new venture, that it was going to be all new stuff, not All Japan, even though there are a lot of things associated with All Japan, not just the talent because of that massive exodus. But in terms of formatting, Misawa wants to change it up, and we'll get into that now. So talking about that mass exodus of talent, the key names, because pretty much everyone from All Japan at that time left, except for Toshiaki Kawada and Masanobu Fuchi, as far as the native talent goes, and then foreigners as well. Most of them, if not all, left All Japan for Noah. That includes Mitsuharu Misawa, Jun Akiyama, Yoshihiro Takayama, Takao Omori, Yoshinari Ogawa, Akira Taue, and of course, Kenta Kobashi. As you can see them wearing the Fortune KK shirt. Fun fact, I wear this shirt sometimes because it's also very comfortable. You can get it on like Pro Wrestling Tees, I think. I don't know, I don't want to like plug their shit because they're not paying me, but you can get it at Pro Wrestling Tees, just look up like Kenta Kobashi, I think. I wear it sometimes and people are like, is that a KKK shirt? I'm like, no. It's like, I have to explain them, oh, it's this wrestler, he's Japanese, but he's not active right now, he's like retired and stuff. So leave it down in the comments if you've ever gotten shit for wearing a wrestling shirt. I know that like Kai and Tai had some funky shirts, so yeah, just leave your thoughts in the comments. So besides all the stuff about Kobashi, you also had, like I said, about all the main event stars. You also had some other guys, like I said, like Vader as well, left All Japan after he kind of had a career resurgence. He left to go with Noah. And then another key contribution from the All Japan roster to Noah is all the junior heavyweights that would later become established names in Noah. Guys like Kenta Kobayashi, not to be confused with Kenta Kobashi, Naomichi Marufuji, Yoshinobu Kanemaru, and Takashi Sugiura. And even though Misawa adopted a lot of the stuff from All Japan, even in terms of style, All Japan follows the King's Road style, and Noah follows the Odo style, O-D-O, with the, like a little dot at the end. It's very similar, but in terms of All Japan to Noah, there are differences in terms of its structure. For example, All Japan focused a lot on the tournaments, like the Champion Carnival and the World's Strongest Tag Team League. Noah didn't start off like that. Only until later on, like 2007, did they start introducing the leagues, like the Global League, the Global Junior League, stuff like that. But they were more focused on its titles, and specifically the GHC titles, the Global Honored Crown, which, if you'll know, like with New Japan, the the governing body, which is kind of like a kayfabe term that they use for all their titles, the governing body in New Japan is the IWGP, International Wrestling Grand Prix. But then for NOAH, it's the Global Honored Crown, the GHC, as in the GHC Heavyweight title, the GHC Junior Heavyweight title, stuff like that. Another change-up is also in terms of the usage of foreign talent or freelance talent. While Baba did sign guys like Stan Hansen, Dr. Death, Steve Williams, Terry Gordy, guys like that, and bring them over multiple times, Misawa was more about partnerships and even working with other Japanese promotions, which is another key that Baba didn't really like to mess around with New Japan and some of the other promotions that were around at that time. But Misawa would bring over like guys like Yuji Nagata, Masahiro Chono, and go to New Japan and some of these other places to kind of form a partnership, kind of a mutual respect in terms of the other promotions. And then for outside promotions, outside of Japan, you have the most famous partnership that they had, which was Ring of Honor during its early days. That's made famous by some of the great matches like Kenta Kobashi and Samoa Joe in NOAH. You also had the great rivalry that was going on of Bryan Danielson versus Kenta. Then you also had other significant partnerships like Westside Extreme Wrestling in Germany with NOAH. You also had some other ones, some other loaning of talent. And then you had Harley Race, his introduction into NOAH in terms of training guys and having guys come over to his own promotion. So stuff like that. But then you also had a less emphasis on the stud tag teams. I know it's like a weird term, but when you think of the tag team scene in All Japan, historically, it's like, you know, Tenryu and Jumbo and Misawa and Kawada and Kobashi and Akiyama. For All Japan, I'm sorry, for NOAH, it wasn't really like that. Their tag team scene wasn't that emphasized. They would have stud tag teams that would hold on to the GHC Tag Team Championships and stuff like that and have high profile matches in some of their big events, but for the most part, it was focused on the heavyweight scene, as in the singles heavyweight scene, and more specifically, which was not the case in All Japan, the junior heavyweight scene. For a while in All Japan, and in some cases now, especially in the 90s, for All Japan, it was pretty much one junior heavyweight. That was Masanobu Fuchi, who was great during his time, but NOAH experimented and saw the landscape of wrestling change as smaller guys were recognized as bigger stars like Rey Mysterio, Jushin Thunder Liger, Eddie Guerrero, Chris Benoit, you name them. For NOAH, they had more of an emphasis on the junior heavyweight scene as they had some of their more talented guys come out of that scene, like the aforementioned Kenta, Naomichi Marufuji, Yoshinobu Kanemaru, guys like that. The early years of pro wrestling NOAH can be categorized as kind of a learning process in terms of, okay, let's kind of throw this out there, let's bring them a stable product, and then kind of experiment from there. For example, they built off of the established All Japan stars like Misawa, who was their early champion early on. Jun Akiyama had a title reign, guys like that. But then they started to experiment by having Ogawa hold on to the title and start bringing in some of more of their junior aces to fill out that main event scene, or to at least take place in some of the tag teams, like have Kenta Kobashi and Kenta face off against someone, or Misawa and Naomichi Marufuji face off against someone. So more establishing of their homegrown talent in a way. The early years also saw pro wrestling NOAH get All Japan's TV slot on NTV, which brought a lot of eyes to pro wrestling NOAH. Also, you had the Differ Ariake Arena. Let me see if I'm pronouncing that right. The Differ Ariake Arena was a home to them for basically setting up a dojo and brought in a lot of good names like Go Shiozaki. There you go. And Eddie Edwards. And I would say the prime years of NOAH would be from about 2002-2005, which was capitalized by Kento Kobashi's legendary 700-plus day title reign that spanned from about 2003-2005. And they had some great shows back then, which I'm gonna reference here. I also wanna do is, during this series, is kind of reference big shows or make match recommendations for you guys to check out. So I'll just kind of go through the list here and kind of pop up some things. So some of their best shows include Navigate Revolution 2002, that's day 10. You had Tsuyoshi Kikuchi, the guy who used to tag with Kobashi during like their early 90s years. So you had Kikuchi and Yoshinobu Kanemaru versus Jushin Thunder Liger and Wataru Inoue, good like junior tag match. Jun Akiyama and Yuji Nagata versus Kento Kobashi and Mitsuru Hamasawa, stud tag match. And after that, you have Navigate for Evolution 2003, day 9. You had Kenta and Naomichi Marufuji versus Makoto Hashi and Yoshinobu Kanemaru. Junior tag match, a legendary junior tag team in Kenta and Naomichi Marufuji. Then you had Kenta Kobashi defending the GHC heavyweight title against Mitsuru Hamasawa. Legendary lineup and a fantastic match. I believe this is probably, yeah, if I'm remembering correctly, this is the match that got me into Japanese wrestling, along with like the Shinsuke AJ Styles match. This got me into stuff outside of New Japan, so definitely check that one out. Then you have Navigation with Breeze 2003, day 17. Yoshihiro Takeyama, there you go, versus Takashi Morishima. Again, like a stud kind of like bruiser, 1v1 match. Yuji Nagata versus Akira Taue. Good match for Taue. He still has, Taue during this stage didn't really have the level of matches that he had in All Japan, but could still break it out in some small matches when needed to. And then Akitoshi Saito and Jun Akiyama defending the GHC tag team titles against Kento Kobashi and Taemin Honda. So you got that. Navigation over the Dateline 2003, day 13. Kenta and Naomichi Marufuji defending the GHC Junior Heavyweight Tag titles against Makoto Hashi and Yoshinobu Kanemaru. You had Michael Modest defending versus Takashi Sugira. Fun match, it was a fun junior heavyweight match. Then Kento Kobashi defending the heavyweight title versus Yuji Nagata. During this time, Nagata was kind of loaned over from New Japan and have these big matches against guys like Kobashi, etc. Encountering Navigation 2004, day 14, Misawa and Yoshinari Ogawa defending the tag titles against Kenta and Naomichi Marufuji, a test of the stud junior tag team against an established heavyweight team in Misawa and Ogawa. And then you had Kento Kobashi defending the heavyweight title against Yoshihiro Takeyama. Awesome match. It's one of the more brutal matches during Kobashi's title reign here. You also have Departure 2004. This is probably, in terms of New Japan's best shows all time, this is like 1A, and the other show that I'm going to talk about, Destiny 2005, is like their 1B show. But this one is stacked. Kenta and Marufuji defending against Kendo Kashin and Takashi Sugira. You also had a ton of New Japan talent all around this show. Again, more of that working relationship that they had. For example, Jushin Thunder Liger defending the junior title against Yoshinobu Kanemaru. And then you had Minoru Suzuki and Yoshihiro Takeyama, their team named the Backyarders, I believe, defending the tag titles against Takashi Morishima and Takashi Rikio. And then you had Kenta Kobashi defending the heavyweight title against Jun Akiyama. Oh, again, another legendary, they are a legendary tag team, but they're also a legendary singles matchup. The kind of, this match is like the burning, exploding kind of deal. And then the aforementioned 1B show is Destiny 2005. 62,000 people at this venue. That's a stellar numbers. You had Kanemaru defending the junior heavyweight title against Kenta. Minoru Suzuki and Naomichi Marufuji, an interesting tag team that would be later on referenced as their rivalry ensued in the 2010s. But them defending their tag titles against Jun Akiyama and Makoto Hashi. You had Takashi Rikio versus Hiroshi Tanahashi, and an early young Hiroshi Tanahashi, and we'll mention Rikio's title run later on. You had Kenta Kobashi against Kensuke Sasaki, the like famous chop match that they just go on like chop crazy for like 5 minutes, it feels like. It's great. And then you have Mitsuharu Misawa against Toshiaki Kawada. Kawada came over for, I believe, this match and maybe a few others. But, you know, legendary matchup. So there you go. Here we go! The middle years of pro wrestling. No, this is when Kobashi was entering kind of the end of his prime, kind of, and all the older Four Pillars guys were starting to exit, so they had to rely on other names. They had problems with relying on freelance talent, for example, Yoshihiro Takeyama. They couldn't really rely on him to be their guy, so then they experimented by having the heavyweight title kind of go around to guys like Takeshi Rikio, who was a former sumo star, didn't really have the best matches, but was not really a reliable heavyweight champion. So then they go, okay, well, let's get it to Naomichi Marufuji, who was going to be established as the ace of Noah later on, but his title reign was cut short and was given to Misawa, which would eventually be Mitsuharu Misawa's last GHC heavyweight title reign, which was not that spectacular of a title reign. He had some solid matches, but for the most part, he wasn't up to par with his work from the 90s and even some of the work that he had in the late 90s, early 2000s. And talking about Kobashi, we can't skip over during June 2006, he was diagnosed with kidney cancer. So it was a very scary thing to happen. He later beat it. But would go on the rest of his career up until when he retired, with dealing with nagging injuries throughout all those hard-hitting matches, stuff with his neck, his arms especially, his knees, just wrecked in terms of injuries. With all the negative stuff, there were some good things. For example, some of the bigger junior stars that were being developed and pushed in the early 2000s were now being brought up to the main event scene. As we talked about before, with Marufuji's title reign, you also had guys like Kenta and Takashi Sugiura moved up and down the card. And while this was all happening, they were having awesome matches, as I'm talking about here. You had the Kenta and Taiji Ishimori match versus Kota Ibushi and Naomichi Marufuji. Awesome, awesome match. You can find it on YouTube. It's just the best junior heavyweight wrestling in terms of just high impact stuff and just them flying all over the place and good psychology, I think. And then we have to talk about Naomichi Marufuji defending the heavyweight title against Kenta from October 29th, 2006. That match is, for my money, probably the best just Naomichi Marufuji Kenta match. It's the best match that they ever had. They would have great matches later on, but for the amount of high velocity stuff, for the just built up drama in that match, it's a great match to watch and I highly recommend it. And unfortunately, all of the good fortunes for Noah kind of halted abruptly, as one night Mitsuharu Misawa was in a match and he took a basic belly to back suplex and was just completely hurt from that. He was carried out on a gurney, and afterwards it was revealed that Misawa died later on that night in the hospital. It was the widely accepted thing is that it was just caused by not that move specifically, but just the wear and tear on his neck through over the years of taking these very dangerous moves, these very high impact moves, specifically on the neck. So that's why you've seen a lot of the scaling back of some of the, we wouldn't say intensity, but more of the unsafe moves, especially in Japanese wrestling, which is a big problem from guys like Misawa and later on guys that have died from simple moves like that. And unfortunately, then this would lead into more of the downturn of Noah in the, I guess, the post-Misawa era. So after Misawa's death, that left a hole in terms of who would lead Noah into the future, in terms of the present roles was constantly changing from Misawa's death up until a certain point where guys like Naomichi Marufuji would come in, then it was Jun Akiyama, Akira Taue, and Kenta Kobashi. And this all kind of led into, in March 2012, Noah was found to have ties with the Yakuza, which kind of brought everything to a halt. They lost their TV deal, they lost a lot of sponsors, and would lead to other things changing. Among these changes, in December of that same year, 2012, Noah releases Kenta Kobashi, which led to a mini exodus, let's say, of five wrestlers associated with Kobashi and the Burning Stable. That included Jun Akiyama, Go Shiozaki, Yoshinobu Kanemaru, Atsushi Aoki, and Kotaro Suzuki, all left to go to All Japan Pro Wrestling. And in December of the next year, Akira Taue retires, which is kind of the last of the four pillars being gone from wrestling. And another departure which really hit them, April of the next year, 2014, Kenta leaves Noah on, some would say, an ill-fated venture, as we would see Kenta come back to the Japanese wrestling scene, but at the time it was seen as a big loss in terms of Noah and Japanese wrestling, as Kenta left Noah to go sign with WWE and later on become Hideo Itami, which, so yeah. And 2015 saw two big shifts happen in Noah. Takeshi Morishima, who was a star in the mid-2000s, he held on to the Ring of Honor world title, he held the GHC heavyweight title, he was forced to retire as there were problems with his blood and potentially having diabetes. So that was another big loss to them. And then the second big thing that happened was Jado, as in Gedo and Jado fame, stepped in to help, you know, steer the ship of Noah, which led to him stepping in as booking, which resulted in the era of Jado booking. So despite his success with Gedo booking New Japan in the early 2010s, Jado brought with him what may describe as one of the worst periods in Noah's history. Even though Jado came in, he brought in an alliance with New Japan. That sounds good. He brought Suzuki-gun with him. That sounds good. Wrong. In fact, Jado kind of brought with him New Japan as kind of an overlord to Noah, as the Suzuki-gun angle Suzuki-gun came in and, you know, was a hot angle early on. This invading force comes in and starts beating the Noah guys. And then they start really beating him. And then really beating him. And then pretty soon they get all their titles. And then it kind of loses its heat. What about the other stars, right? They're gonna do some things. Well, part of that New Japan alliance, Noah wrestlers were brought in to New Japan to compete in tournaments like the Best of the Super Juniors and the G1 Climax, and they kinda got jobbed out. If you could look at the Super Junior, the Super J Cup bracket, pretty much all the Noah guys were eliminated in the first and second round, and it was just down to Suzuki-gun guys and New Japan guys in the later rounds. And then the G1 Climax, while Naomichi Marufuji had a great match with Okada and even beat Okada, they did not play a significant role and were jobbed out kind of in the later era of the G1 Climax. So Jado later steps down in the later part of 2016, as fans got completely turned off by all this happening, especially the Suzuki-gun stuff, and Jado left Noah along with Suzuki-gun. So what I'm gonna call the post-Jado era after coming out of a sloppy 2016 and kind of a 2017, Noah has found a rhythm in terms of their stars, in terms of their shows, and it's been great to see. Their 2018 to now has been very strong in terms of building on their established guys like Go Shiozaki, Naomichi Marufuji, Takashi Sugiura, and building up their future with guys like Katsuhiko Nakajima, Keno, and some other guys, and bringing in great foreigners to contribute. The aforementioned Eddie Edwards, who had trained at NOAH, came in for a few matches, and Chris Ridgeway, who's been helping and killing it here, and Alex Hammerstone, who's been a part of NOAH's new partnership with Major League Wrestling, MLW, and they formed another relationship with Impact that didn't really solidify. It was kind of an early experiment, but their MLW partnership has been helping out a lot. And talking about some of the highlights here, I just gotta mention a few things. Rattles. Again, this is kind of like the layman's version of NOAH, so if I fuck up the spelling, hey, whatever. But Rattles, which is a group that has Daisuke Harada, Yohei, and a few other juniors, they're a junior heavyweight based stable that are very entertaining and have been killing it in this kind of later stages of NOAH, and are extremely popular, even to the level of drawing comparisons to Los Ingobernables de Japón. One of the two favorite things that I have with NOAH is Takashi Sugiura and his run as JC Heavyweight Champion in 2018. Just as like a gruff guy who's just gonna come in and just beat all of these younger guys that are trying to ascend to his status, he would eventually get beaten by Kaito Kiyomiya, but he would have these awesome matches and a fantastic match, which you gotta check out, his match against Katsuhiko Nakajima. It's kind of this story of the old gunslinger, the old veteran against like this cocky shit heel in Nakajima. And talking about Kiyomiya, that's another highlight of this later run, is his meteoric rise to main event status and holding it down as the top babyface in NOAH and having these great matches. And then my second favorite thing is Go Shiozaki and Katsuhiko Nakajima forming axes and just being an awesome dickhead tag team. Nakajima was originally paired up with Masaki Tamiya and having a good team there, but Shiozaki, Nakajima, just, you know, kind of stiff dickheads that are a great tag team to watch. So the history does look promising for NOAH with guys like Kiyomiya and some of the younger guys like Keno, who will hopefully be their stars of the future, and through partnerships with other promotions like MLW, and especially going forward into 2020